morning, Harvest.
Good morning.
This Wednesday, of course, is Veterans Day, and we wanted to take a few moments right at the beginning of the service today to honor and pray for all of our veterans and their families. And this morning, as we begin our service, I'd like to ask all of our armed services, as I call the branch you have served in, if you would please stand and remain standing for just a second. We want to take an opportunity to honor you personally here at Harvest Christian Center. So if you served in the United States Army or are serving in the United States Army, would you please stand? Any Army vets? All right. Praise the Lord. How about remain standing, please. Remain standing. How about the United States Navy? Any Navy? U.S. Air Force. Any Air Force veterans in place today? All right. Praise the Lord. How about the Marines? How about the Coast Guard? Anybody serve in the Coast Guard? How about any of the Reserve or the National Guard? You guys remain standing. Those of you who can, please remain standing for just a second. All of our veterans. Harvest, let's give all of our veterans a great big hand. This is what I'd like us to do for our fellowship time today as the praise and worship team and Pastor Derek come and get in place to lead us into the presence of the Lord. Look around and see where the veterans are standing. As you get up and fellowship with one another, go greet them, shake their hand, hug on them, tell them you appreciate them and their service, and welcome any of our guests today too. God bless you.
Yeah.
The endless love of God. Amen. 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 Love mercy is from everlasting, and His grace is sufficient. Someone has been struggling with sin and addiction, and they've been busy apologizing, been busy asking for mercy. But God says, my grace is sufficient. What I want from you is praise. If you would just make a joyful noise unto the Lord, He will fix it. He says, it's He that has made you, not you yourselves. Enter your gates with thanksgiving, into His courts with praise, and be thankful unto Him, and bless His name. And as you praise Him and bless His name, He'll give you the strength to drop that addiction or that sin. It's through the praise. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise in this house. Let's make a commitment to bless His name today. You may have the seats. Let's give our praise team a hand clap of praise. Amen. We're so glad to have Tammy's mother and sister in the building. Keep waving your hand. Your name is down front. Praise God for them. Can I have our ushers make their way to the front at this time? What our ushers have in their hand is a gift for our first-time guests. Do we have any first-time guests in the house? Can I get you to raise your hand? Any first-time visitors, first-time guests? Got one out here in the front, second row? Let's give our first-time guests a hand clap of praise. Amen. We have in your bulletin, you see a connection card. We want to, please fill out your connection card. We want a record of your visit. On the back, we have comment cards and prayer requests. Please, if you have any prayer requests or comments, place it on the back. We pray over those at least 2 or 3 times a week. Amen. I know we prayed during our prayer time during the week, and I just prayed over 3 this morning again. Amen. I believe prayer changes things. Amen. Pastor Rick will be coming later to give our offering. But what I want to do, I want us to join in prayer for some prayer needs here in our congregation. We believe prayer changes things. I don't think I'm wasting time when I pray. I believe things are happening in heaven that's going to manifest itself on earth. Please, would you join me in our prayer time at this time? Father, we thank you for the praise and worship this morning. We thank you for your love that never fails, Lord. Even though we fail you time and time again, we thank you for your love that looks past our fault. Lord, we thank you for paying the debt that we couldn't pay. Lord, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for when we don't know the words to pray, you know our heart. You know what's in our heart, and you can interpret that and give us what we need. Lord, we pray this morning for Miss Maureen Robish and the Robish family, Lord, that is in hospice. Lord, I ask you to put your spirit there, that whoever would come to visit, they would experience your presence. Lord, I ask you to anoint Ed right now, a husband that she's been married to for 62 years, anoint him to do the work of the ministry, that those that would come in to see her, that you would use him to minister to them. Lord, we ask you to restore the joy and the peace. Take away the pain right now. Lord, we ask you to use even Reed, Rick, and Ed during this time. Lord, I thank you for the time we had for the family and with the family. Lord, if it's your will, I ask you to raise up and heal a body. But if you're tired and you're looking for rest, Lord, you said in your word is a rest that remains to for your people. And Lord, give a rest. Lord, we pray for Miss Sylvia Kelly, Lord, as she recovers from back surgery. Lord, we ask you to keep the pain away, restore the joy, give peace and patience to the caregivers. Bless Mike, that as he stand by our bedside, renew his strength. Lord, we thank you for James Hamilton, even in the service today. We thank you for the joy that is inside. That as you look at him, you see the smile on his face. That you know that he came in contact with the living God, and he lives inside of him. But we pray for Alan Warren is dealing with kidney. We actually heal him. Jimmy Baker continued to heal and unclog every artery, Lord. Unblock every blockage. Even the things that are blocking his prayer life, Lord, unblock it. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we continue to pray for Mike Mead and give him clarity of thought. Let him think on the high things and how the goodness of Jesus, that a praise of God remained on his lips. We thank you for protecting Wes Alvarez. Lord, as someone hit him on a motorcycle going over 100 miles per hour, that you protected him. You protected his mind. You protected him through the surgery. And Lord, we pray for his 100% healing, that he may take his place in the kingdom of God, lead his congregation. And Lord, we pray for laborers and workers that will go out into the harvest and do your work. We pray for laborers that will work with our children church. We pray for laborers that as we go forward to help those with special needs. We pray for laborers. We pray that you provide supernatural resources for your work going on here at Harvest. Buses that's handicapped, cable. Well, we pray that you give equipment and projectors and all type of resources, supernatural. And we continue to pray for our president and our leaders of Congress. Lord, protect the family. Put being around them with godly wisdom, that you would speak through them to our leaders, God, that they may bring us back to one nation under God. Acknowledge you as Lord and King and our Savior. And Lord, we continue to pray for our missionaries, the Argo family and the Presley family. Lord, we ask you to protect the missionaries. Lord, as they, with the language barriers, as they speak, Lord, give them your anointing. That even though they might not understand everything that's said, but it will break every yoke and every chain, that the people will come, Lord, to hear the gospel. And Lord, we continue to pray for Harvest and church unity. As we go forth, Lord, we go forth as a unified front, taking back the ground that the enemy has taken. Lord, we actually send revival, and we actually bless the leaders, Pastor Rick and Pastor Tammy. Lord, make the vision plain to them. And as the leaders here get behind the vision, let us go strong after you and make a difference in this community. All the blessings we ask right now in the name of Jesus. We say amen and amen.
Amen. It is good to see Brother James in the service with us today. And praise God for his faithful hand, strengthen him and bring him here. For all the needs, we give God praise in advance. Amen? For the great work that he is doing, it's good to see all of you here today. And we come to a very fun time of our part of worship and our worship service today, and that's our time of giving. How many are excited about giving to God? Amen. I see a few of you are. Offering, I've got to say how delighted I am to have my mother-in-law and Tammy's two sisters in the service with us today. Because we've ministered away most of our life, I can probably count on less than two hands the number of times we've been able to have them in service with us today, because usually they had to travel a number of miles. But not today, probably less than 10 or 12 miles. So we're glad to have them in service. Would you make Tammy's family welcome today? My family, welcome. Sister visiting all the way from New Jersey. Hallelujah. good to have you here today. And we want to take a moment to thank you so much, Tammy and I do, for the pounding we took last Sunday. Now, normally poundings are not a pleasant experience, but I got to tell you guys, blessed us so much last Sunday. And we want to thank you from the bottom of our heart for four big, huge boxes full and overflowing of food and various things that are going to help us get a start. Thank you so much, Harvest. You're already showing your heart of generosity, and we appreciate that so very much, and we're already enjoying it too. And I did want to make one more announcement just before we receive our tithe and offering and I read the scripture. Is next Sunday we're going to begin prayer time in a different fashion. Over in the education building there's a room that's going to be cleared out. It's going to be clearly marked Sunday prayer, and it's going to be open beginning at 9 a.m. every Sunday for anybody who wants to go over and pray for a minute or two, or pray for the full 30 minutes. We're going to have it open for you to pray for the needs of the church, but also for our Sunday morning service. And it's going to be open from 9 till 9:30. We're going to have some worship music playing in there for you as you go in, and it's going to be strictly for prayer. So we invite you to come next Sunday if you'd like to, from 9 to 9:30. Like I said, you can go in and pray a few minutes and come on over. Or you can pray until right before the first note of music starts and come back into the service. So that'll be next Sunday over in the education building in our prayer room. It is a privilege to give to God. But it's also one where God challenges us. And we know what Malachi says because that's the most popular tithe scripture in the Bible. But today I want to read to you from Ecclesiastes chapter 11, verse number 1. It says, cast your bread upon the waters, for you will find it after many days. Now this is a principle, we're not really talking about giving per se here, but it is a principle of God that anything you give to Him, you're going to get back. And we also know what the New Testament scripture says, we're going to get back good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Now we don't give because we're going to get it, we give because we love God. We give because we trust Him more with our money than we trust anybody else with our money, including ourselves. Can you say amen for that? And so today as you give, as I challenged you last Sunday, God loves a cheerful giver. So just before the brethren come and I pray over the offering, I want you to smile at somebody next to you real big. Because God loves a cheerful giver. It generates laughter every time. And so as you give today, we pray the blessings of the Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the privilege of giving today. We ask, Lord, that you take our tithe, which belongs to you, which we're giving back to you. Because we know, as John prayed for supernatural resources, we know where those resources come from. They come from our source, who is you. And so, Lord, whatever compensation we received over the last few weeks, we know that the first tenth of that belongs to you, and we sow it with gladness of heart today, trusting you that you're going to take it and multiply it into the work of the ministry called Harvest Christian Center. And God, for the offerings that are given above and beyond that, your word says, try me in this and see if I don't pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. So we submit them to you now, asking that you bless the tithe and the offering, those that are able to give and those that are not, Lord, that you would provide seed for the sower. And all this we ask and give thanks in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you as you give, and let's continue to worship and praise the Lord this morning. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
God. Good to see you all in the house of the Lord today. And we have some folks that are back with us for the first time in a while. We welcome you and so glad to have you in God's house. And how many of you are glad to be in church today, Harvest? Amen. Nothing but a little liquid sunshine is not going to keep us out of the house of the Lord. We praise God for the rain because heaven knows we need it, right? We might not think we do, but we do need it. And we're grateful for that. Last week, I began a four-week series on the church, and last week we talked about the upward direction of the church being worship, and in that upward direction of the church, we give ourselves to Him. And I believe today in the midst of our worship, where it says nothing here is hidden, we don't hide anything from God when we come into His presence, because it doesn't do any good. Can't hide anything from God. He already knows. So you might as well just open yourself up. So the first place in the four directions of the church was the church in worship. And this week, after I preached that message, I got a wonderful Facebook tag on a picture that describes worship. Let's bring that up. Miss Robin sent this to me, and it defines worship as W, wait upon the Lord. O, offer our lives as a living sacrifice. R, rest in His presence. S, sing unto Him. H, humble ourselves before Him. I, intimacy with God. And P, pleasing Him. And I think that's a really powerful definition of worship. Amen. So thank you, Robin, for sending that this week. And I wanted to share it with you because I thought it sums up last week's message very, very well. And so the first direction of the church is upward in our worship of God. This week, I want to talk to you about the second direction of the church, and that is the outward direction of the church, and that's called evangelism. Taking the gospel of Jesus Christ outside the walls of this church, outside of our normal church activities, and reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the go direction of the church. This is the movement direction of the church, and we're going to talk quite a bit about that today. But I want to open with reading Acts chapter number 2, verses 46 and 47. Now, I've read from this passage of Scripture the entire passage before, but today I'm just going to concentrate on 46 and 47, because this is a description of the first church, when the church was birthed after the day of Pentecost, when Peter stood up and preached his powerful message and many were saved and added to the church that day. This is how it talks about the church growing. In verse 46, it says, "So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved." Now let me refocus on verse 46. "Continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house." They didn't keep the gospel inside the temple. Now there were some practical reasons for that in that day, because it wasn't a popular message yet. But how many of you believe we're getting to that place in America where in some places the gospel is not a popular message anymore? And so they began evangelizing by taking the message of the gospel house to house. Well, Pastor, how do you know they were evangelizing? How do you know it wasn't just a bunch of Christians getting together for a small group? Now, I love small groups and I love Christians getting together, but that's not what it was about, because somewhere, somehow, there had to be people to be added to the church daily. Right? That's what it says, that the Lord added to the church daily, and it came as a result of them sharing the gospel house to house, not just with believers, but with those surrounding their homes that they invited over and told them about Jesus. What a novel idea, amen? Let's pray over the reading of God's word today. God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for your church, and we thank you, Lord, for Harvest Christian Center, a corporate body of your church that you have plugged us into today. And we ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit, who is in this place already, release the power of your word through your servant today, that you would continually mold us and shape us into the image of your Son. And for all of that, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. So from the very beginning of the church, of course, Peter stood and preached and many were saved, but it wasn't just up to Peter. Everybody say amen. Wasn't just up to the preacher to get people saved. They started meeting together and breaking bread together. And we've talked several times about how the Lord knew the church was going to be an eating church. And in 2 weeks, we're going to talk about fellowship. We're going to spend a great deal of time on fellowship. But as they were gathered together, they met and they shared a meal together. And then someone or several someones within the group began to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news. And I'm telling you, it was a fresh message back then. And can I tell you, it's just as fresh today, just as powerful today, just as rich today, because there are many people, and we all know many in our own lives, that need to hear and see the message of the gospel preached in their lives. So we see already in evangelism the outward direction of the church. God didn't call us, remember, He didn't call us to come to church, He called us to be the church, right? And so we have a responsibility when we leave here, we go out into the mission field. And just to get a plug in for Wednesday nights, before I go any further, Wednesday night we began a two-week series on the four prayers of harvest, the four points of prayer for harvest. And if you missed the first two last week, it's okay. We're going to review them this week before we go into the last two. And they go right along with this series of messages on the church about how we need to pray that the Lord will empower us and enable us to fulfill the Great Commission and evangelize our world. Amen? How many of you know you all have a world? Some of you's world's crazier than other people's worlds, but we all have a world, right? Some of you's world, you might feel messed up, but we all have a world. And God is in the midst of it. And if we'll honor Him by sharing the message of the gospel, we'll see the church advance and the kingdom of God advance. Mark chapter number 16, verse 15. We're all familiar with these passages of Scripture that refer to the Great Commission. And we find them in all three of the Synoptic Gospels. Now we know there's four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But three of them are referred to as the Synoptic Gospels, or Gospels that have similar stories and share similar things about the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. So in all three of these Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we're starting with Mark today, we find reference to the Great Commission. Here it is in Mark 16, 15. And He said to them, go. Everybody say go.
Go.
Everybody say go real loud.
Go.
I expected somebody to say go real loud. Did good. And He said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Everybody needs to hear the word of God. Sometimes we filter who we think needs to hear the Word of God, right? But everybody needs to hear the Word of God. Everybody needs to hear the good news that Jesus loves them, that Jesus came to this earth in the form of man, and that He died on a cross to forgive them of their sin, and He rose from the third day, and He's sitting next to God this morning calling out our name. They need to know that. We see it in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 through 20. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. These are the two most popular and most famous passages of Scripture about the Great Commission. But we see it in Luke as well, just spoken a little differently. In Luke chapter number 24, verses 46 through 49, Jesus speaking, and He said to them, thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. And that repentance, and here's the Great Commission, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are the witnesses of these things. If you're a child of God today, you are the witnesses of these things. And the mandate that Jesus spoke in Mark and in Matthew and in Luke is that we are to share this message of love, hope, and forgiveness to a lost, dying, and hurting world. The world needs Jesus. And Jesus has chosen God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, has chosen the method of our mouths to share this message. Sure, we live our life, and I believe it was either Moody or Spurgeon that says, preach the gospel and if necessary, use words. Well, that's a powerful phrase, and it speaks to living a life that matches your words. But can I tell you, He wasn't saying, don't use words, just live your life. Because the Bible says He's chosen the foolishness of preaching, of sharing the message. And that is a spoken word. So not only are we supposed to live our lives, but we need to have the boldness and the confidence in Him, empowered by the Holy Spirit, to speak our faith. Because I'm telling you, there's a lot of people that can watch you casually for your whole life, but when you stop and take a moment to tell them about Jesus and tell them what Jesus has done for you, it'll make a difference in their life. And you're fulfilling the Great Commission. You're operating in the outward direction of the church. So we see in Matthew 28, 19, Mark 16, 15, Luke 24, 47, one of the four things I want to share with you about evangelism today, about the outward direction of the church, and that is go. Everybody say go. The second thing we see in Matthew and Mark, in Mark chapter 16, if you read further, is we are to make disciples. Making disciples is a lot different than making converts. Amen? When people get saved, when I got saved, that was not the end all for me. I have been on a 35-year journey since then, continuing to learn things about God, continuing to learn things about me that God reveals to me, continuing to allow God to operate in my life and to take away those things that need to be taken away and replace them with things. I love it. My wife shared with somebody this week one of our favorite quotes: God's not trying to get something from you, He's trying to get something to you. And anything He removes from your life, it's not to take it away, it's because it's in the way of what He's trying to get to you. So understand, when God begins to remove things in this discipleship process, that He's trying to get some new things to us. How many of you like new things? We're coming into a season where everybody's anticipating new things, right? Some of you already have your list that you've given to the appropriate person. Some of you gave that list out the day after last year's Christmas Day, right? Of what you didn't get this year. We all like to get new things. So I'm telling you, God desires to get new things to us. And sometimes that requires, through the discipleship process of becoming fully devoted followers of Christ, where church is not just something we do on Sunday because it's something we do on Sunday. Church is something we do because we love coming and worshiping God with a group of fellow believers in a corporate environment that you can't get by just worshiping God in your house. Now, don't stop worshiping God in your house. And if you don't worship Him in your house, worship Him. Start in your car, in your house, at work. But there's nothing like gathering together. But we come in here not to just get filled up and blow up. We come in here to get filled up and go out with the message of the gospel. Because if we just came in here all the time and never shared anything out, one day we're going to blow up. And that's not going to be a pretty picture when that happens. But God equips us. So we see the go. We see the making of disciples. And then the third thing I want us to look at in this evangelism, the outward direction of the church, is we don't even have to worry about doing it within our own power. I know a lot of people who are afraid to witness, a lot of people who are a little afraid or trepidatious about sharing their faith. They're a little they don't want to be rejected. They don't know how it's going to come across. Can I tell you don't even have to share your faith on your own? Look at Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 8. Acts chapter 1, verse number 8. I think I skipped one. I'll go back to it. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Back up now to Luke chapter number 24 and verse 49. It says this: Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. Now I'm going to tie those two scriptures together. First, Jesus is telling his disciples, you go into Jerusalem and you wait there until I endue you with power. Everybody say power. Power. Everybody say power like you're not afraid of it. Power. Everybody say power. Power. What if your stuff at home ran on power like that? Power. We can get very much done. Say power.
Power.
He's going to give us power. He says, go and wait there. You know where Jerusalem is? It's your home church. It's right here. It's Harvest Christian Center. If Jesus was standing up here today, he'd say, I want you to tarry at Harvest Christian Center until you are endued with power from on high. And that person that brings the power is who he's talking about in Acts chapter 1. He said, stay there, tarry there until you are endued with power. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. Everybody say, Holy Spirit. He's my friend. You can say that. That's still the repeating part. He's my friend. And he's my helper. And so if you want to know how to share your faith or get better at sharing your faith, be endued, receive the power that the Holy Spirit has for you to share your faith. We see in Acts chapter 1, the first thing that he gave the power of the Holy Spirit to do was for us to be witnesses. To be witnesses everywhere we go. How do I know everywhere we go? Jerusalem. That would be the area we live in. That would be, for us here, Cantonment, the surrounding area. Judea, that would be Escambia County, Santa Rosa County, Baldwin County, Alabama. That'd be the areas that are around us that are kind of like us and similar and demographic to us. That's our Judea. And then there's Samaria. Well, you know, he was talking to the Jews when he said that, and the Jews and the Samaritans did not get along at all. They did not hang out together. They were a different demographic. God says, I want you to share the gospel with the different demographic. Maybe it's a socioeconomic demographic. Maybe it's a language
demographic, whatever it is, God says, share the gospel with everybody. And then, of course, we know what the last one is, to the ends of the earth. That's our world missions and the missionaries that we support. And by the way, I talked to Al today, and we're looking at sometime early next year to have them come and to share with us. So we're thankful. Most of us are not going to go to the foreign mission field. Some of you have already been, but most of us are not going to go. But we can send others. Amen. And when we get to heaven and God opens our spiritual eyes, we'll see where our gifts that help send those missionaries, help them touch people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is a go message. It's the outward direction of the church. Now, I love worship. I told you last week, I love coming to church. I love the presence of God. I love being in a corporate environment where we lift our hands, we open our hearts, and God just comes and fills this place. But He doesn't just come to fill us so we can just enjoy His presence. He fills us to equip us to go out and to share this message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, the math is simple. I didn't think to get it, but the thought just hit me. I've seen the equation before, that if all of us take this year and commit to winning one person to Jesus Christ, and the next year all the people that we won plus us commit to winning one more person to Jesus Christ, and I think it's within about 7 to 9 years that we will have quadrupled the size of the kingdom, or better. We would have reached almost the entire world with the message of the gospel. That's with one. What if we reached one a month? What if we led one person a month to the Lord? What if we shared our story 10 times, and out of those 10 times, one person, at least one person got saved? Hallelujah. Well, what about those other 9 times, Pastor, when they don't hear and they don't respond? Look, it's not up to you. He says, some plant the seed, others water the seed, but God gives the increase. See, when we do our part, God will do His part, because He is a faithful God. And so in this church that we're beginning in together, in this journey that we're beginning in together, as your new pastors, and this is the last month I get to say new pastor, right? The rest of November I say new pastor. Beginning in December, we're not new pastors anymore. We're old. Well, I don't know. Don't use the word old. Some other word that you can come up with. Season. Thank you. I like that. Good season, pastor. So as we begin this journey together, God has orchestrated this series of messages. And one day I'll tell you the story of how He put it together before we even got here, on these series of messages on the church, so we can launch this thing, this new season of harvest together. And these prayer points come out Wednesday night. We had who all was here Wednesday night? Did we have a good time in Bible study Wednesday night? Man, we had a blast in Bible study. So come out Wednesday night and hear the rest of that. The Holy Spirit gives us power to witness in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And here's the deal. Even the Apostle Paul, which next to Jesus, the Apostle Paul is my favorite Bible character. He's my favorite person in the Bible next to Jesus, because he was a church planner. He was an evangelist. He won people to Jesus. He won people to the faith. In 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, I want to read this passage of Scripture to you, verses 19 through 23, because this is a how. Some of you may be asking, okay, Pastor, we know we're supposed to go. Jesus has told us to go. And by the way, those were some of Jesus' last instructions to us, was to go. So we need to pay attention to His last instructions as well as all of His other instructions, right? So here's Paul. Paul says, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. And to the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, I became as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who were without the law. To the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that by all means..." Now, don't go to the next scripture yet. I want you to save that. Verse 23, "that I might by all means save some." Paul was not saying he became a Jew. Now, we know that Paul was part Jew, but he didn't say, "I became a Jew." I became as a Jew. That means he began to understand their culture and how to speak to them and how to talk to them. He didn't say he became as one without law. Paul knew the law, or one with law. Paul knew the law better than anybody because he was also a Roman. So he knew the law, and he knew the Jewish law, and he knew all of those things. And he said, I became as one with the law or under the law, even though he was no longer under the law, he was under grace, but he wanted to understand them so he could win them. Then he became as one without the law, those that are not under the law, but under grace. Those would be the Gentile people. And unless you're a Jew in here, you should rejoice that Paul took the gospel to the Gentiles, else you and I would not be in here today. Amen? So he became as those without the law so that he could win them. And then he said he became weak. Now, there is not a thought in my mind that ever pictures the Apostle Paul as being weak. But he said, I became as weak so that I could win the weak. He didn't become weak. Jesus, when he died for us, he didn't become a sinner. He became as a sinner. He was tempted in every way like we are, yet without sin. So the Apostle Paul has given us the how right here. If you're going to reach people, you don't have to become them. And I'm telling you, that's a mistake that the church world has made over the last 40 or 50 years, is thinking we have to become the world to reach the world. I didn't get one single amen, but it's the truth. And that's why now the church is in the shape that it's in the Western culture, is because we've become so much like the world that there's no difference between the world and the people of God. And so Paul wasn't saying become the world. He said become as them. Learn their culture. Learn how they speak. Learn what they respond to. Learn how they think. And then go in and reach them. When you go into I've got friends by the way, thank those of you who prayed for Pastor Wes Alvarez. I saw pictures of his motorcycle, and the first couple of pictures I saw, I didn't recognize it as being a motorcycle. Now, Wes wasn't going 100 miles an hour. The car that hit him was going 100 miles an hour on a motorcycle, and he's on his way home today with just a big, he's going to have to do some physical therapy on his knee, but no head injuries. God protected Wes Alvarez. But there's guys in ministries like that that go into places that maybe some of us wouldn't go into. But they don't go in there and sit down and do all the things that they're doing. They go in there and sit down and watch their culture, and they begin to win them. Now, I'm not suggesting that you need to do that, but there's a culture where you live. There's a culture in your neighborhood. There's a culture at your workplace. Paul says, become as them. Get to the place that you can think what they think, not necessarily do what they do, so you can speak to them and touch them right where they live. Jesus didn't take people away from where they live to win them. He won them right where they are. And so in this go message, the church, the outward direction of the church, we're told to go. Verse 23, here's the motivation. Now your motivation has to be right. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you. Paul says, I don't go and do these things because I want to. I don't want to go and do these things because they make me look cool or they make me look trendy. I go for the sake of the gospel. Our motivation has to be to build the kingdom and to expand the kingdom of God. Because I'm telling you, through that is why you and I are saved today. Now, some of you may have got saved in church. I've told you Tammy's story. Her mama's here today. She was in church from the time that she could go outside. All three of them were. A lot of people don't have that great honor and privilege to be able to live a life that way. And somebody spoke Jesus into their life. Somebody spoke Jesus into your life. Somebody evangelized you. And so it's important that we take what God provided for us and we provide it to others. I'm thankful today for the people who spoke Jesus into my life. So we see in Paul, first, invite. We have to invite people into the kingdom. Turn to Luke chapter number, if you have your Bibles, Luke chapter 14, verses 16 through 24. And this is the last scripture I'm going to share with you today. Jesus speaking said to him, a certain man gave a great supper. Now this is the parable of Jesus that teaches us the principle of the importance of going and telling. Everybody say go. You still out there? Everybody say go. All right, this is Jesus' parable of the wedding feast. And in this parable, he teaches us this principle of going and going and going. Here we go. Then he said to him, a certain man gave a great supper and invited many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are ready. Now, leave it right there for just a second, verse 17. Now, in this passage of Scripture, clearly, this is referring to the people of Israel who were the God's chosen people originally, right? But I want you to follow this whole story and get the principle of what God is trying to speak to us today in this outward direction of the church. Verse 18. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. Now listen to me. Sometimes when you invite people into the kingdom of God or even to come to church with you, how many of you have had somebody give you an excuse as to why they couldn't come? Right? Jesus knew it way back then, over 2,000 years ago, that folks were going to be making excuses. And he said, the first said to him, I have bought a piece of ground and I must go and see to it. And I ask you to have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to test them. And I ask to have me excused. Still another said, I have married a wife. And therefore, can I tell you, when you get married, that is no excuse not to come to church. In fact, that's a good reason to start going to church if you didn't. Amen? Hallelujah. I got a few amens. One of them was a little too exuberant. We'll be... Tammy and I will stay after a little while after church today, after the baptism. I play it. Still another said, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and reported all these things to his master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city, and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. And the servant said, Master, it is done as you commanded, and there is still room. How many of you are grateful there's still room? Amen. And there's still room. Then the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house might be full. Verse 24. For I say to you that none of those men who were invited, and that's implied invited originally, shall taste my supper. Those who make excuses and don't come, those who don't respond to the invitation to join this great family of God and receive Christ as their Savior, they'll not be allowed into the great supper. You and I have a great supper awaiting us. If you're saved and you name the name of Jesus Christ and you've received Him as your Lord and Savior, we have a great supper waiting for us. Hallelujah. But if you don't respond, you can't go. So in this passage of Scripture, we see 4 things. Number one, invite. Some will reject, but keep inviting. Don't stop inviting just because somebody rejects. Because here's what we need to understand. As we go out in this outward direction of the church and evangelism, if we invite and they don't come, they're not rejecting us. They're rejecting the master's invitation. We are the messengers. And he sent his messenger out and he said, go and tell them to come in. So invite. Don't stop inviting. Well, Pastor, I invited so-and-so to church and they just won't come. Keep inviting. Keep inviting, because you don't know when the time is that they're going to say yes and come. It's a story I've shared many times that I'll share real quickly here. We were pastoring in New York. We had a visitation program where each week the bus captains would go out and visit the people on their route. And they would pick up the little girl and bring her to Sunday school every week. And every Saturday when she went home, she would go to her mom. And she would say, Mom, would you please come to church with me this Sunday? Because the kids couldn't come on Sunday unless their parents came with them. It would just be too many kids if they came on Sunday. And she did that week after week after week after week. She would go home. She wouldn't tell them about the game she played or anything else. She would tell her mom the Bible story that she learned, the PowerPoint for that week. And then one week she came home. She told Mom the whole story of what happened at Sunday school and what she learned at Sunday school. And then she got ready and she said, Mom, would you? And then she just suddenly stopped and she said, never mind, you're just going to say no anyway. And the mom stopped at that moment and said, no, honey, go ahead and ask me. What were you going to ask me? Even though she asked the same thing every week, her mom had forgotten. But she said, Mom, would you please go to church with me this Sunday? And she said, yes, I will. And that little girl's whole family, her 2 brothers, her dad and her mom, went to church that next Sunday. And that next Sunday, her mom, her dad and her 2 brothers gave their life to Jesus Christ. And then a week later, their entire family was baptized. And over the next few months, they brought more people to church than anybody else in that church. Because one little girl kept asking, kept inviting. Don't give up on inviting. So the first principle is to invite. The second principle is to invite some more. When you've asked them and they've continued to give you excuses, find somebody else to invite and ask to come. Do you love your church? Do you love Harvest? Are you glad to be at Harvest Christian Center? Well, why don't you invite somebody to come to Harvest Christian Center with you every week? Every week to come, because you don't know what God is going to do in their life. Share your faith with them. Begin to tell them what God has done for you and invite them. And then the third principle we see in verse 23 of that passage of Scripture is keep inviting. Invite some more, and keep inviting. This is the outward direction of the church, is to go and to tell. Invite people to get to know Jesus. Invite people to hear your story. Invite people to church. Because I'm going to tell you something. A lot of salvations are going to take place outside the walls of this church, and then they're going to come with you. But you've got to be telling them all the time. You've got to go and to tell, just like Jesus said to do. And then the fourth thing that we see in this passage of Scripture is the only way to be able to eat the Great Supper is to respond to the Master's invitation. That message is for those we invite. And sometimes it's for those who are sitting right in here that maybe have gone to church a lot in your life, but you've never really responded to the Master's invitation. Don't just think because you're in the building. Remember what he said at the, they're not going to be able to eat. Those who heard the invitation and didn't respond, didn't come in, are not going to be able to eat that great supper. So the principle we see is we keep inviting, God gives the increase. But the important thing we know is the only way to be able to eat the Great Supper is to respond to the Master's invitation. But the only way they can respond to His invitation is if the invitation is given. It's if we point people to Jesus. See, in our act of worship in the upward direction of the church, the act of evangelism flows out of that act of worship. Because we're not going and telling them because we want them to do something we want them to do. We're going and telling them because we know who the King is. And we know what He's done for us. And we want Him to be able to do for them what He's done for us. And even greater things. In fact, Jesus, in that passage of Scripture where He says, greater works than these shall men do. He wasn't talking just about all the great miracles and signs and wonders that God did on the earth. He was talking about pointing people to the Father. He said, I'm not even here on my own authority. I've come to point people. I've come to do what He says and to point people to Him. And greater works than these. That means greater evangelism are we going to be able to do because of the power of the Holy Spirit that's inside of us than even what Jesus did. So as excited as I am about the upward direction of the church, I'm just as excited about the outward direction of the church. And I'm thankful here at Harvest we see outward signs all the time. But can I tell you, in the time in which we live, God's about to ramp all those things up. Are you ready for the journey? Are you ready to go? Everybody say go.
Go.
Now you're afraid I'm going to get you to commit to going, aren't you? It's not important that you commit to me. It's important that you commit to Him. It's not my mandate. It's not my great commandment, great commission, it's His. His great commission is to go. And go is not just in here. Please come. Every time these church doors are open, it's going to be worth your while to come because the presence of God is here. Not because I'm here, not because Tammy's here, not because your friend's here, because God will meet us here. Amen? And He will do things in our midst. So come, be here all the time. But don't just wear your faith here. Live it out loud out there. You're going to hear me say live out loud a lot. Because I believe that's what God wants us to do, is live out loud. Live our faith out loud. The world is screaming at the top of their lungs, trying to drown out the voice of the kingdom. Guess who the voice of the kingdom is? You and me, the children of God. So we need to live out loud, speak out loud, talk out loud, share our faith and give it to Jesus. Give all the glory to Jesus. And invite people to come into a relationship with Him. It's all about going. Come in here, get fired up and filled up, then go out and touch the world with the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Remembering this one thing, that unless you respond to the Master's invitation, you will not participate in the Great Supper. Would you bow your heads with me? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Before I move any further in the service, I believe that the Lord had me add that fourth point to speak to the heart of someone or maybe a few that are in church today but aren't in the kingdom yet. In church today but haven't responded to the Master's invitation to receive His forgiveness, to come in and be a part of His family. So before I move to another part of our prayer time, I'm going to ask our prayer team to come and stand on either side of the baptistry for just a couple of moments. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you're here today and you'd say, "Pastor Rick, I've heard the invitation many times. I know the story. I know what Jesus has done for me. But today the Spirit of God has reminded me that I've never fully accepted the Master's invitation to come and to be a part and to receive all that Jesus has done for me." If you're here today and you'd say, "Pastor Rick, when you get ready to close, please include me in your prayer. I need to receive Jesus Christ. I need to come and respond to the Master's invitation to have my sins forgiven, have them washed away, to have my name written in the book, to be sure of my salvation and my destiny. I don't want to be one that continually gives excuses." And can I tell you, today's the day for no excuses. If that's you and you say, "Pastor, as you close in a moment, please pray for me. I need to ask Jesus to come into my life to be my Savior." Just raise your hand up right where you are. You need to receive Jesus today. There's no more important part of the service than this right here. God's lined it out and orchestrated it for you. Is there anyone today that needs to ask Jesus into their life and respond to the invitation to come to the Great Supper? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask that you all stand this morning. Now, the service is not going to be over when we pray in just a moment. We have the glorious privilege of baptizing a young lady today. We want you to stay and be a part of that wonderful time of observing the ordinance of the church of water baptism. So please, when we pray in just a moment, it's not the end. We want you to sit back down and we're going to have our baptism service. If you're here today and you'd say, "Pastor, I'm one of those ones that has difficulty sharing my faith and sharing what Christ has done for me, but I know that being a part of the church, this great church, it's more than just about worship. It's about going." If you're here today and you say, "Pastor, I want to commit myself afresh and new to being a voice of the kingdom, to be one to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ." If that's you, I just want you to lift your right hand toward heaven right now, and I'm going to pray over all of us in this place that we will be greater witnesses for Him. Maybe you've witnessed some, but you want to be even more effective. Maybe you've never shared your faith much at all, but what I want you to do right now is just lift your hand up and I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you have a need while we're praying this prayer, if you have a need in your body or any type of need in your life today, I want you to come and join hands with these that are across the front. They're going to pray and agree with you. You do that while we're praying. And Derek's going to lead us in a time of worship before we have the water baptism. But if you have your hands raised, I'm praying for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we lift our hands in surrender and submission to you. God, and in obedience to you, we ask that you would empower us by your Holy Spirit. Empower us by your Holy Spirit to be your witnesses, to share what you have done for us and the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are hands raised, Lord, some that may have never shared their faith outside their family or outside their church. I pray that you'd give them the boldness of the power of your Spirit to be released in their life to share the good news of the gospel. Others that have shared their faith before, but God, we live in a culture and a time that people need Jesus so desperately. A world needs Jesus so badly because the world's screaming so much stuff that they can't hear the gospel. We need more voices. And so, God, we ask that you would empower us even more than ever to be your voices in the kingdom. In Jesus' name, God, empower your people. Holy Spirit, fall upon them right now. Those that have their hands raised to be a greater voice, let your Spirit fall upon them right now. Baptize them in your Spirit, Lord. Empower them to be your witnesses in their home in Jerusalem, outside of their home, in their neighborhood, in their Judea. to people they don't know in their Samaria. And God, that we would do all that is within us to sin and maybe even in some instances go and to touch the world. But God, help us to live out loud, live our faith out loud. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Continue to worship the Lord. If you need prayer, continue to come as Derek leads us as we prepare for the water baptism.
To you, our hearts are open. Nothing here is sin. And you are of one design. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down.
Sing it, sing it to you.
I'd like all of you who will, as an act of surrender for the Holy Spirit to fall on you afresh and new, to lift both of your hands up toward heaven. We're going to sing that a couple of times through. My prayer is for those of you who desire the fullness of the Spirit of God to be released afresh and new in your life, you receive it today in the name of Jesus. Because I'm telling you, when we go out of here with a word on fire, we will touch people's lives. Amen. With our spirits on fire, our souls on fire, we'll touch people's lives. So let's lift both of our hands toward heaven and let's sing this morning. Hallelujah.
I'm
Spirit, we thank you for filling us afresh and anew, for sweeping over us and touching our spirit and our soul. God, we thank you today that you've committed us and instructed us and inspired us and reminded us that the outward direction of the church is to go, to evangelize, to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to go and to make disciples and to baptize. Hallelujah. Oh God, we give you glory today. We give you praise in your house today. We commit ourselves to the go message of the kingdom, the outward expression of the church, to evangelize, to share the message of the gospel. In Jesus' mighty name, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you love Jesus today?
Yes.
Are you thankful for the power of his Holy Spirit?
Yes.
Are you thankful for the challenge that he's given you today? How many of you welcome that challenge? Put your hands together and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Give him a good shout while you're clapping your hands. Come on. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Spirit of God. You can be seated for just a moment. It's a great honor and privilege as a pastor to be able to baptize people so they follow the Lord and his direction of baptism. And Paul in the book of Romans describes this by saying in Romans 6:3, do you not know as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so also we should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also will be in the likeness of his resurrection. Miss Addison, this is the part that applies to you. Knowing that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Identifying your life with that of Jesus Christ. 7 years old. Wow. To know that you love Jesus that much already, I need to come down there, don't I? I'm not going to be able to baptize you from up here. I got long arms, but they're not that long. Wow. 7 years old and beautiful. Isn't she beautiful? Talked to her this morning, asked her if she was ready, and she said yes. And I said, well, Addison, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. She said she was ready for my questions. Is the water warm or is it cold? It's warm. Good job, Reed. Hallelujah. I came by here last night, Tammy and I, to pray, and I stuck my finger in the water, and it was so cold. I thought, whoa. Maybe we got it warmed up. You love Jesus, Addison? You asked him into your heart to be your Savior and your Lord? Are you going to live for him? Are you ready to be baptized? It's a special day, isn't it? You have some family here with you. I know your mom, dad are here. Others are here with you too. All of Addison's family, wave at us right here. Look, the whole front right here. Well, based upon your public profession of Jesus Christ, and by the way, she answered yes to all those questions. You didn't hear this quiet little voice up here. But based upon your public profession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you now in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. God bless you. Come on, let's rejoice today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Whoa, come on, put your hands together. Let's praise his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Everybody,
today, can't clap and pray for the message. Several people stood for honoring the veterans. But I did 26 years in the Navy, but what what I'm most proud of would be in the arm of the Lord. How many is in the arm of the Lord? Amen. What? Veterans, you know, we obey orders. And you're in the arm of the Lord and you have your marching orders. The pastor just gave us our marching orders. The Bible says that obedience is better than a sacrifice. Obedience is better than asking for forgiveness for not doing it. Amen. As we have our marching orders, we want to pray and dismiss you. Father, we thank you right now for our marching orders to go. Invite. Share the good news of the gospel. Invite them to the great summer. Lord, as we go today, Lord, give us creative ways to invite our co-workers, our families, our neighbors, God. Lord, power us with your Holy Spirit. Give us what to say and how to say it, God. That your house and your table will be full. And Lord, we just thank you for what you're about to do. And Lord, as we go, let the peace of God and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit rest and abide and keep his people now and forever. And let everyone say amen.